Blessed and beautiful Monday morning to you, brothers and sisters in Christ, and welcome to another edition of Morning Prayer brought to you by the Anglican Diocese of Belize. Today is the 12th of October. I nearly said the 12th of December. Imagine that. It's the 12th of October and it's Pan American Day. I am not sure if it is actually National Heroes Day. Somebody needs to correct me on that. I will tell you the truth. No lie, in all honesty, I have been so out of whack with regards to the months and the days and what holiday it actually is because of how we've been living in the past 10 months with regards to this pandemic. But praise God, we have made it through to this point, and we remember fondly those who did not make it, offering up their souls to the care of Almighty God. But we give Him thanks for the fact that we are here and we are able to continue the good work which He began in us. Amen. We're going to start this morning, not with the sermon I just gave, but with our opening hymn, one entitled, Lord God of Morning and of Night. Let's have a listen.
Our Father, He lives from the ashes. He raises the poor and the lost. He seats them to dine at His table, to feast without money or cost. The lonely He settles in families, the barren a mother He makes. Oh, happy the heart of the stranger, who's welcomed by this King of grace. Who is like the Lord our God, who with glory fills the sky, but humbles Himself with the broken to dwell. Who is like our God? Though equal to God in His glory, Christ Jesus became like a slave. He humbled Himself in obedience to death and the cross and the grave. Victorious He rose to the highest, in glory the Savior was raised. His name above all names exalted, the heavens and the earth sing His praise. Who is like the Lord our God? Glory fills the sky, but humbles Himself with the broken to dwell. Who is like our God? O saints, fix your eyes on the Savior and count all your righteousness lost. Found in His love and His favor, and share in His death on the cross. Let all of His power and victory imparted to you may abound, in sharing the sufferings of Jesus, you share in his glory and crown. Who is like the Lord our God? Who with glory fills the sky, but humbles himself with a broken to dwell? Who is like our God? Who is like the Lord our God? Who with glory fills the sky, but humbles himself with a broken to dwell? Who is like our God?
You see how early in the morning the Reverend is lying. The song we just heard is one from Wendell Kimbrough called Who is Like the Lord Our God? And I'll tell you what will happen. Lord God of morning and night was less than a minute long, the recordings I could find. And so I changed it, but I did not change the name on my sheet. There you go. So I hope you enjoyed that one from Wendell Kimbrough, Who is Like the Lord Our God. Let's get our words here up on screen for today, October the 12th, 2020. And we will continue with our morning devotion. There we go. I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Words from Psalm 122, verse 1. Using versicle 1, if you are following along, we begin on page 35 in our books of common prayer. Blessed be the Lord our God, by whose grace we are yet alive. Blessed be his Son, Jesus Christ, by whose rising we are set free. Blessed be the Spirit of God, in whom is our hope and our joy. Our invitatory prayer. Father, we come together in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer you our worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and glory. You are the source of all goodness. Let our worship bear witness to your peace and saving power. Through your Spirit, may we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen. Our first canticle this morning is the Canticle de Jubilate, based on Psalm 100. Oh, shout to the Lord in triumph, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his face with songs of joy. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Come into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his holy name. For the Lord is good. His loving mercy is forever. His faithfulness throughout all generations. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now and shall be forever. Amen. At this time, we pause to call to mind those things that in thought, in word, or in deed we would have done that would have been displeasing to God, that would have been unfair to our neighbors, or that would have been unjust even to our very selves. For these times and these moments, Lord, we pray to you for the forgiveness of our sins. We make our confession by saying together, have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins. Give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Psalms for this morning are Psalms 1, 2, and 3. Psalms 1, 2, and 3. Happy are they who have not walked in the counsel of the wicked, nor lingered in the way of sinners, nor sat in the seat of the scornful. Their delight is in the law of the Lord, and they meditate on his law day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water, bearing fruit in due season, with leaves that do not wither. Everything they do shall prosper. It is not so with the wicked. They are like chaff which the wind blows away. Therefore the wicked shall not stand upright when judgment comes, nor the sinner in the counsel of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked is doomed. Why are the nations in an uproar? Why do the peoples mutter empty threats? Why do the kings of the earth rise up in revolt and the princes plot together against the Lord and against his anointed? Let us break their yoke, they say. Let us cast off their bonds from us. He whose throne is in heaven is laughing. The Lord has them in derision. Then he speaks to them in his wrath, and his rage fills them with terror. I myself have set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. Let me announce the decree of the Lord. He said to me, "You are my son. This day I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will give you the nations for your inheritance, and the ends of the earth for your possessions. You shall crush them with an iron rod and shatter them like a piece of pottery. And now, you kings, be wise. Be warned, you rulers of the earth. Submit to the Lord with fear and with trembling bow before him. Lest he be angry and you perish, for his wrath is quickly kindled. Happy are they all who take refuge in him. Lord, how many adversaries I have. How many they are who rise up against me. How many they are who say of me, there is no help for him in his God. But you, O Lord, are a shield about me. You are my glory, the one who lifts up my head. I call aloud upon the Lord, and he answers me from his holy hill. I lie down and go to sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. I do not fear the multitudes of people who set themselves against me all around. Rise up, O Lord. Set me free, O my God. Surely you will strike all my enemies across the face, and you will break the teeth of the wicked. Deliverance belongs to the Lord. Your blessing be upon your people. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Our second canticle for this morning is canticle number 9, the first song of Isaiah. It's based on Isaiah chapter 12, verses 2 through to 6. Surely it is God who saves me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. For the Lord is my stronghold and my sure defense, and he will be my savior. Therefore you shall draw water with rejoicing from the springs of salvation. And on that day you shall say, give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make his deeds known among the peoples. See that they remember that his name is exalted. Sing the praises of the Lord, for he has done great things, and this is known in all the world. Cry aloud, inhabitants of Zion. Ring out your joy, for the great one in the midst of you is the Holy One of Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Our Bible reading for this morning comes from the book of Micah, chapter 7, verses 1 through to 7. And it reads, woe is me, for I have become like one who after the summer fruit has been gathered, after the vintage has been gleaned, finds no cluster to eat. There is no first ripe fig for which I hunger. The faithful have disappeared from the land. And there is no one left who is upright. They all lie in wait for blood, and they hunt each other with nets. Their hands are skilled to do evil. The officials and the judge ask for a bribe, and the powerful dictate what they desire. Thus they pervert justice. The best of them is like a briar, the most upright of them a thorn hedge. The day of their sentinels, of their punishment, has come. Now their confusion is at hand. Put no trust in a friend. Have no confidence in a loved one. Guard the doors of your mouth from her who lies in your embrace. For the son treats the father with contempt. The daughter rises up against her mother. The daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Your enemies are members of your own household. But as for me, I will look to the Lord. And I will wait for the God of my salvation. My God will hear me. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. If you allow me a few seconds, brothers and sisters, to get back to the beginning of the reading from Micah, we will continue our look at the book of Micah. And unfortunately, the book of Micah ends very shortly because, of course, Micah only has 7 chapters. Now, one of the things that this is a cheat that I'm going to tell you, I had planned 1 year to read the entire Bible from beginning to end, from January until December. And I cheated because I had originally planned to read the Bible chronologically. And then what happened is that you get into genealogy in the Old Testament. And I, you know, the genealogy becomes boring with all of these names. And so what I did then was I started to read the shortest books. The book of Micah, of course, being one with 7 chapters, was one that I knocked out pretty quickly. And I decided it would be a chapter a day and I would get through the whole Bible. But Micah is almost finished. And of course, the last time we were together, which would have been on Saturday, we would have looked at Micah chapter 5. And you would notice that today we go into Micah chapter 7, which means that Micah chapter 6 was missed. And just to give you a brief recap of what Micah chapter 6 was all about, it is all about the Lord complaining against his people. Now, all along, Micah had, through prophesying from God, been telling the people of the wrongs that they have been doing. And in Micah chapter 6, it is almost as if though God brings the people of Israel, the nation of Israel, into a court scene. And I must have wanted to be a lawyer in a different life. But in Micah chapter 6, what happens is Micah paints a picture of the court. And Israel is on trial before the Lord. And God is asking Israel, okay, what have I done against you that you are repaying me with the kind of rejection and rebellion that you are showing? And that is the basic theme of Micah chapter 6 that leads into Micah chapter 7. And we, of course, today will look at verses 1 through to 7. And chapter 7 is all about Israel's confession and their comfort. Now, after being put on trial in Micah chapter 6, the people of the nation of Israel now seem to be willing to turn away from their sins. They are going to turn now from their sins and they are making their confession here. And it is God's people, I guess in a moment of humility, humbly, I guess, confessing their sins. And it's an honest confession of their sinful state. And on behalf of the sinful nation, the prophet Micah confesses the sins of God's people. And what he does is he first recognizes that their sins had left them impoverished. Yes, their sins had left them in a state where there is nothing for them. Woe is me, for I have become like one after the summer fruits has been gleaned and after the vintage has been gleaned, who finds no cluster to eat and there is no first ripe fig for which I hunger. And I have to stop here because when I read this yesterday, you know, we always call things first ripe. I wonder if it is not first ripe and first ripe the thing is supposed to be. Is here a Creole change thing? Anyhow, well, and Micah is complaining that because of their sinfulness, the fruitfulness of the land had disappeared and there was nobody who was left upright or righteous. Yes, and he talked about the fact that in their sinful state, all had lied in wait for blood and all was turned one against the other. And he describes some of their specific sins and their general character, revealing their deeply ingrained sinful nature that, of course, played one against the other. And it's interesting because all of verses 1 through to 4 is like that. And listen to verse 4. The best of them is like a briar and the most upright of them is like a thorn hedge. So even the best of the best in the society that is so evil is still really far from the heart of God. And all this Micah is telling them is because of their sinful state. And he goes on in such a way that he is convicting the people of their wrongs and confessing on their behalf. And what I find interesting is that it paints a picture of the fact that When a sinner is immersed in sin and feeling successful, they feel like there is no price to pay for the sin. How often have you not looked on someone else and wrongfully compared yourself to their state of well-being? But look at that one. You know, go to church, you know, acknowledge God, you know, do nothing to help others, and he is prospering. We don't know the difficulty or the turmoil that they live in internally when we look at people like this. And Micah is seemingly trying to point out that when someone is lost in their wrongdoing, they figure they have no price to pay. They're just going to live out the benefits that they are enjoying because of this wrongdoing, not thinking of the consequence. And I thought to myself, as a child, my philosophy was simple. If it is wrong and you do it, they're going to beat you. Better enjoy it while you do it, because they're still going to beat you. And this is not, don't laugh, this is not good advice for young children. And thankfully, hopefully no young children watching this morning. But that was my philosophy. And I would enjoy the wrong I was doing because I knew I was going to be punished anyway. So I might as well live the moment while it lasted. And praise be to God, I outgrew that foolish rationale. Yes, that way of thinking and reasoning has now been lost upon me in my old age. And so I don't do that anymore. Because now I am more aware that there are consequences to my actions and that the decisions that I make affect not only my well-being, but the well-being of others around me as well. And so how I act and react a lot of times is important because of the fact that it has far-reaching effects in this life and in the next. And the people of Israel did not seem to consider that. And it then goes into, Micah goes into verse 5 through to 7, talking about the crumbling relationship that existed among God's people. And this one is important for me because a lot of the times, friendships are destroyed based on a lack of consideration in the acts of the individuals in the friendship or in the relationship. And Micah is saying here in verse 5, 2 to 7, don't trust in a friend. And it was because of their rampant sin and sinfulness and selfishness, their personal relationships had crumbled between them because there was no justice, there was no honesty, there was no real communication. There was only the thinking about benefiting of oneself versus care and concern for the other. And it's sad because to hear of put no trust in a friend and have no confidence, not even in a loved one, guard the doors of your mouth from her who shares your pillow, basically. So you can't trust anyone. How do you live a life where there is no trust? How do you live a life where the people around you, you have to be so guarded around them? That can't be an enjoyable existence. And one could not trust in a friend or put confidence in a companion. And even blood relatives were at war with each other at the time of Micah's prophecy. I mean, the nation itself had divided into two separate kingdoms. And I am sure that families were divided, not only because they were in exile by Assyrian rule or by other rulers over them, but because they themselves, those who chose to serve Yahweh and those who chose to serve false God, would have had discrepancies between them that would have led to their separation of each other. And then comes verse 6, which sounds familiar to us. And why does it sound familiar to us? Verse 6 says, son treats father with contempt, daughter rises up against mother, daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. Your enemies are members of your own household. Remember in verse 5 when we looked at it, Micah had promised the coming of one who is humble from born in Bethlehem. You remember that? And we had said that it was a reference perhaps to the coming of Jesus as the Messiah. long before the time of Jesus. And the word from verse 5 of chapter 7 is something that Jesus would have preached in his day. Do not believe that I have come to bring peace, but to bring destruction, to turn son against father, daughter against mother, daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. In the one household, the two will be divided against one. You remember this passage of scripture? And I should have looked it up, and I thought about looking it up last night, and I must have been tired because I went to sleep early. But these are exact words that Jesus then would have used in showing that in the kingdom of God, there can be no division. You are either in or you're out. And if you're not for us, then you are against us. And Micah was saying that this type of sinful, lawless, godless existence affects the relationship around us, because it creates a barrier or a divide when we can't see. And I chuckled to myself in reading it. I grew up in a family where half of the family was one political party and the other half of the family was a different political party. And we would have family events, and the rules was simple, because half of the family was Anglican and half of the family was Roman Catholic. And so it was simple. Half of the family was Hispanic and half of the family was Black. Things that were not discussed in any family gathering: race, religion, or politics. Because we were one family. And even though we had differences between us, we didn't discuss or harp upon those differences, because we knew that trying to discuss those differences would mean the tearing apart of the fabric of who we were. Family. And in this instance, Micah was showing that if we are immersed in a sinful culture, there's only going to be a few persons in whom we could find confidence, in whom we would find compassion. Only those who would be looking to the Lord. And what a beautiful thing when we can actually find someone who is like-minded to us, in whom we can trust, in whom we do not have to be afraid to share our very selves. And what a heartbreak it is when such a confidant betrays that trust and we are left alone again. And Micah is saying, the truth of the matter is, in verse 7, me, I will look to the Lord, and I will wait for the God of my salvation, and my God will hear me. Because unlike human beings, God, as a divine being, will never forsake me, will never hold contempt against me, will never break my trust. It is a bad thing when people should be honorable and trustworthy enough that you could find confidence in them and they are not. But the comfort is this: we can trust in God, and he will never fail us. God can use even a situation of disappointment where others have let us down to help us to remember that true confidence should only be given to him. That true comfort comes only from him. That in him alone we should trust. Amen. We continue with our morning prayer then, with our profession of our faith, a faith that we hold in him who is above all else. We profess our faith, saying, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. As our Savior has taught us, so let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen. For our suffrages, we use Form A on page 43. Lord, reveal your love among us, that we may know the joy of your salvation. Grant peace within and among all nations, and teach our leaders wisdom. Endow your church with faithfulness, and your servants with knowledge and true godliness. Defend, O Lord, the rights of the poor and the oppressed, that your justice may be known among all people. Lord, renew your spirit within us, that in us and through us your will may be done. Our collect for the day is the collect for Proper 23, which can be found on page 179 in our Books of Common Prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that your grace may always precede and follow us, that we may continually be given to good works through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A collect for the poor and neglected. Almighty and most merciful God, we remember before you all poor and neglected persons whom it would be easy for us to forget, the homeless and the destitute, the old and the sick, and all who have none to care for them. Help us to heal those who are broken in body or spirit, and to turn their sorrow into joy. Grant this, Father, for the love of your Son, who for our sake became poor. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. At this time, we turn our thoughts and prayers to those of thanksgiving, giving God thanks for those who celebrated birthdays or are celebrating a birthday today. Yesterday, we had Naya Young and Marcy Claire who celebrated a birthday. Miss Rose Garbutt Malays and Mr. Brandon Hall also celebrated a birthday yesterday. Celebrating birthdays today are Mr. Ed Nunes, Miss Avis Nicasio, and Mrs. Debbie Ritchie Jones. We pray and ask for Almighty God's blessing upon you as you celebrate the anniversary of a new year of life, and indeed we ask God's blessing upon you for all the days ahead. We continue to offer our prayers of thanksgiving unto Almighty God, and we continue to pray for healing and recovery for the following persons: Miss Judith, Miss Monica, Miss Margaret, Miss Mary, Miss Ines, Miss Eileen, Miss Sylvia, Miss Harris, Miss Pauline, Miss Des, Miss Janice, Miss Marva, Miss Rose, Miss Jane, Miss Sonia, Miss Gertrude, Miss Agnes, Miss Grace, Miss Justine, Miss Felicia, Miss Celine, Miss Yolanda, Miss Donna, and Miss Ellen Franklin. We pray as well for our brothers, Mr. Hilbert, Mr. Rudolph, Mr. Eliseo, Mr. Normando, Mr. Cecil, Mr. Larry, Mr. Finley, Mr. Rupert, Mr. Leon, Mr. Kenrick, Mr. Costa, Mr. Enrique, Mr. Wilfred, Mr. Oscar, Mr. Ian, Canon George, Mr. Limsford, Mr. James, Mr. Michael Soberanis, and Mr. Michael Samuels, Mr. Alfred, Mr. Nicholas, and young Emery, Norman, Jordan, and Mario. We continue to pray for comfort for those who have lost a loved one recently, and those who are still bereaved over the loss of a loved one. We pray for God's comfort and healing to be upon you, and we pray for eternal rest for those who have died. We continue to pray for protection over our loved ones who are far away from us. We remember in our prayers our students Tammy, Anwar, Karina, Courtney, and Ashley. We pray for wayfarers at sea, persons in cruise ship quarantines and other forms of quarantine, persons stuck in countries not their own due to the closure of borders. We continue to pray for our loved ones in the military, remembering Emil and Jade at this time. We continue to join in prayer for the enablement and protection of all medical professionals in the performance of their duties, praying specifically for Dr. Molina, Dr. Manzanero, Dr. Joseph, Dr. Arana, and Dr. Shogreen. We pray as well for Nurse Gill, Nurse Aurel, Nurse Joycelyn, Nurse Merlene, Nurse Aaron, Nurse Alberta, and Nurse Alejandra. We continue to ask God's healing upon those who are infected with COVID-19, and we continue to pray for a cure or a vaccine for this disease. We pray for the containment and elimination of COVID-19. We continue to pray for the combating of the economic fallout caused by this global pandemic, praying for those industries most severely affected. We remember in our prayers the poor, the needy, the elderly, and the most vulnerable in our society, praying for God's protection and provision over them. We continue to pray for the security forces, the government, those in positions of public trust and authority, the leadership of the church and God's people. We pray for the private sector and all non-governmental organizations involved in the fight against COVID-19. And finally, we remember in our prayers the members of the international community who presently suffer as a result of COVID-19. We pray for our neighboring countries who are experiencing hardships and political turmoil. And of course, we ask Almighty God's protection over us against natural disasters. For the prayers of our hearts that our tongues cannot confess, we pray that Almighty God would hear our prayers. We conclude our intercessions by praying together. Almighty and eternal God, sanctify and govern our hearts and bodies in the ways of your law and the works of your commandments, that under your protection now and ever we may be preserved in body and soul. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. By means of announcement, brothers and sisters, I want to thank you for joining us for morning prayer this morning. And as well, I want to thank you for joining us for the Eucharist led by the Bishop and the people of St. Peter's yesterday. We want to thank all those who made that wonderful service possible. I remind you of our services today. At noonday, we have midday prayers, followed by children's Bible minutes, and then we have evening prayer and compline. We thank you for your continual support of the work of the diocese and indeed the support of our online ministry. I do pray you have a blessed and peaceful holiday today. If you are traveling either to or from home today, please remember to take the necessary precautions in order to keep yourself and your family safe. We'll conclude our service then with the prayer of dedication, the grace, and our final hymn. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our paths, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and to serve all persons in the power of the Holy Spirit, and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now, brothers and sisters, may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. We close this morning, brothers and sisters, with the hymn, Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. And because it is a holiday and you're going to just make the most of it, we're going to send off in a somewhat upbeat vibe. So let's listen to this version of Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. I pray you have a blessed and beautiful day, and I look forward to seeing you tomorrow. Until then, God bless and bye for now.